reading several verses of scripture, beginning at verse number 47, Matthew chapter 13, beginning at verse 47, inviting you to stand if you're able for the reading of the word. Jesus is teaching another parable that I want to try and share with you today, a rather sobering one. As we read it, you understand why. The parable of the net. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a net that was cast into the sea and gathered of every kind, which when it was full, they drew to shore and sat down and gathered the good into vessels, but cast the bad away. So shall it be at the end of the world. The angels shall come forth and sever the wicked from among the just, and shall cast them into the furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Father, we again approach your throne today and pray as we would convey the truth that you have quickened our mind and our heart with, that it would be profitable to each of us today to recognize how serious this journey is, how much we do need to be in prayer, and how much we do need to be settling it to go with God. So Lord, we'll give you thanks and praise for your faithfulness among us here today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Thank you, you may be seated. This parable has a close connection with one that we dealt with some weeks ago about the wheat and the tares, the soils, and all that grew up in those soils, and the wheat and the tares. Here, Jesus picks the truth up, and he brings it back down in another setting. Another aspect to it. Fishermen would use their net, their drag net, we would call it, their drag net to sweep out of the sea all kinds of fish. They would draw it up on the shore, they would separate the fish, that which was marketable to that which was not marketable. The good they would keep and the bad they would cast away. When we began our ministry back in 1988, taking our first church, we did so down in Atlantic, North Carolina, down on the coast. I was privileged on one or two occasions to go with the guys on what they call long haul fishing. They would have a large fishing troller, that large fishing boat with a big belly to it that had holds in there where they could place the fish. But prior to putting the fish in there, they would fill that belly of that boat up with ice, with chipped ice. We'd leave real early in the morning. I don't know how many hundreds of pounds of ice they must have placed inside that great big boat and sealed it up to keep it as best they could throughout the, because this is a whole day pool, a whole day deal. I mean, a long day. Early in the morning, when it's yet dark, they make their way out into Core Sound, and when they find the location where they wanted to do their big long haul for the day, they would go to a certain point and begin to, they put one end of that net overboard. They may anchor it with some sort of a distaff or a pole of some sort. There were other times, when, depending on what they're trying to accomplish, they would have another boat that they would attach it to, and the boat would go the opposite direction they would go. And they're pulling this massive net out of the boats into the water. I don't know for sure how long that net was, but my understanding is quite commonly with long long halls, it would be 1,000 yards long. That's quite a distance. 1,000 yards long. It seemed to me it was a couple miles. It was a long haul. 6 feet deep. You would have floating devices on the top of that net and weights on the bottom. They were literally out to get everything that might happen to be swimming through that waterway that day. And they would pull that slowly until it's all extended, and then they would just kind of sit there for a few hours, letting it happen with that net drawn across the waterway, areas where boats could still pass. It was all properly marked and proper location and all of that. But finally, when it was time, they would begin to draw that net together. And if the boat on the other end was being utilized, then the two boats would begin to make one huge, massive circle. And they would keep circling and keep going until they got that net down to a reasonably small area so that they could begin to fish that net. And I mean, this is a big operation. It's all day long, very tiring. I got weary just being there and the sun baking us all day long. They had a massive dipping net. I mean, I'm talking something bigger than this pulpit, of a huge net that had a heavy line attached to it with the flywheel, the engine running and the flywheel turning. They would use that to get that net out and to drop it into the water and begin to pull those fish up out of the water, over into that hold, dump them in the hold. There'd be guys down in there. They would be sorting the fish, what needed to be sorted, discarding whatever they might want to discard, and packing it in ice, shoveling the ice from one location to the next, covering the fish as each of the batches came in, until they would fill that with hundreds and thousands of fish of every stripe, everything imaginable that they would catch. And eventually to the dock they would go and unload their goodies, some for human consumption, some to go in dog food, cat food, all of that sort of thing. Huge operation, quite an experience. My wife got to do it a few times in that we would do a smaller setting where we would use gill nets. And in the shallow water where we could jump overboard, we would set those nets with the boats, and you would see the fish jumping, the jumping mullets, and that would be the cue. And boy, the fishermen would work real quick. They would gas the engines of that boat, drop the net overboard, and make a big circle in that area where they saw the fish jumping, try and draw it together. And then we would jump overboard because it was in a shallow enough area they would do this that we could jump out. And the problem was, my wife didn't like it, but those jumping mullet would try to jump out of the net. It was floating also. They were supposed to get caught in their gills, caught in the net, so we could have them for supper that night. But some of them were trying to jump out and over. I can still hear, "They're getting away, they're getting away." And going around and trying to shoo them, you know, that they wouldn't jump out. We're circling the outside of that net, trying to scare them so they don't come out, but they try to go through the net. And we catch them, and onto the grill they would go, and wow, talk about good eating. But quite an experience of these drag nets, or the gill net, or the net type of fishing. The parable that we have read this morning, and the one that is somewhat alike with the wheat and the tares, they're alike in that there is a present mixture of what they would catch. There's the good and the bad, the marketable and the non-marketable. But the fundamental difference is that for each of us, there is coming a day when it will be sorted, the good from the bad, and it'll be a permanent thing. It's not going to be just a fishing expedition that may be exciting or exhausting, depending on which aspect of the whole deal you're involved in. But there is coming a day when there will be a permanent separation of the good from the bad. An evangelistic church, one that we are trying to be here at the Lebanon God's Missionary Church, by its very nature has within the congregation, at any given moment, we can have those that are serving Christ and those who aren't. We have sinners and saints. We have people of every stripe. And so to condemn the church because it contains sinners is to miss the point altogether. The whole purpose is to have a congregation, people that you can minister to, and saints and sinners alike, so that we can grow in the Lord and people can find the Lord, and there can be any number of amount of progress that is happening as we gather in a setting like this and throughout the Sunday school hour, all kinds of things happening. The mission of the church, after all, is to help the fallen, to cheer the faint, to heal the sick, and to lead the blind, as one writer has said. It's not for us to judge the needs nor the needy, but we are to, by God's help, be able to recognize the needs and to be a blessing and a help to the needy, and to have a ministry that is to both, to those of every kind. The story is not finished until God himself closes the books. The account is settled. God closes the book, and the judge of all the earth balances the ledger. After all, shall not the judge of all the earth do right? And he will, won't he? God will not in any way miss it. When he judges the earth, it will be accurate. It'll be separated, the good from the bad, accurately. There won't be anything that causes him to make a miscalculation. He knows exactly the condition of each of us. By the net may be understood the preaching of the gospel, the casting of the net, as it were. We're making that fishing expedition today. The net is being cast, and we're endeavoring to reach people with that net. We're endeavoring to connect with people and to give the gospel of Jesus Christ to others. By the sea that is talked about here is represented the life that we live, the world that we live in, the abyss of sin, the error, the ignorance, the wickedness in which men live and out of which they are drawn. And thank God for the day when the net was cast and God spoke to your heart, God spoke to my heart and drew me in and drew us to his side and rescued us from the perishing life that we were in. Oh, thank God for that. The drawing to shore can be represented by the consummation of all things, when a proper distinction will be made between those who served God and those who did not serve God. For many will unfortunately be found that maybe bore the name, but they didn't bear the nature. They didn't bear the experience of the forgiving grace of God in their life. So it's a parable for everyday life. It's a parable that is suitable for you and for me, for the everyday aspect of life. Most of the disciples lived in the general area where fishing businesses prospered. So Jesus had good material here to share a story like this with. A great time to share such a parable, and they would quickly identify with this story, for they had often seen exactly what he's talking about. The drama of the dragnet, the experience of trying to reach as many fish, to gain as many fish as they could. And we read of it in the scriptures. We can almost imagine the mass of fish with the sun shining on their scales, you know, and what they would experience in gathering those fish onto the shore. Jesus admired wholesome toil. Jesus had an appreciation for those who labored, and no doubt took great delight in telling the simple story of everyday life to the masses that he was speaking to, that they could profit spiritually from this. He was connecting here and connecting there with the stories of life. The simplicity of Jesus in his teaching is one of the things that makes him so likable, and that individuals can connect with him so readily, because he taught things and took people down paths that they were somewhat familiar with, that they could identify with. But there is the diversity of the kingdom's members. One thing stands out as quite significant in our Savior's ministry. He had an across-the-board approach. This across-the-board approach that reached men and women of all temperaments, of all lifestyles. He appealed to all. There really was no other religious leader that has ever lived that could connect with the whole as Jesus did. You think about the Oriental religious leaders, they couldn't do it because they were too mystical. Greek philosophy could not do it because it was too academic. Islam could not do it because it was too militant. It was only Jesus who could reach out as he did and connect with people on their level, with things they could identify with and draw them in. He was the source of creation, but he's also the goal of creation. When we grasp the centrality of Jesus, the centralness of Jesus, right in the midst of it all, when we grasp that, we can see all other things in relationship to him. He's the hub. Everything else comes around and connects with him in one way or the other. Jesus connecting with all. Joseph Plunkett said it like this: I see his blood upon the rose, and in the stars the glory of his eyes. His body gleams amid the eternal snows. His tears fall from the skies. I see his face in every flower. The thunder and the singing of the birds are but his voice, and carved by his power, rocks are his written words. All pathways by his feet are worn. His strong heart stirs the ever-beating sea. His crown of thorns entwined with every thorn, his cross of every tree. He's the Christ of every crisis, the songwriter said. We can just identify with him in so many aspects of our life. No matter what we're facing, Jesus can identify with us, and he swoops in to meet the need. He extends the net to meet the need, to take us in, to allow us to be ministered to in what he wants to accomplish. The urgency I sense this morning is that we make sure that we're not left out. We make sure that we're not left out. Jesus purposes to save whosoever will. He purposes to rescue the perishing, to care for the dying, to minister to the needs of the whole. And we don't want to be left out. We want to respond to his entreaty. We want to respond to his faithful way of speaking to our heart, of quickening our mind, of speaking to our conscience. May it ever be a tender conscience and a step that is ever willing to be taken in his direction when he's ministering to the needs of our life and ministering to us. The gospel net is flung into the world. It attracts people in great abundance. And some, of course, do not respond. They excuse themselves. They choose to be unbelievers. They resist the very impressions of the Holy Spirit. That's a frightening thing. The Bible tells us there will be those who will be separated, the good from the bad, those who miss it, those who go into everlasting punishment, everlasting damnation. That is serious. You talk about a wake-up call. You talk about something that ought to bring us to full attention and full alertness, is that God just now is casting the net. He's doing everything he can to rescue all, to save all. May there not be those who jump over the net. May there not be those who resist his faithfulness to us, but that we respond. Because there are those who are excluded because they turned away. There may be those who begin well. They start the process. They may pray at an altar of prayer, but then they fail to follow through with that. They fail to walk in the means of grace that God has for them and to be a faithful follower of Christ. And thus, they resist the Holy Spirit. And in the end, I fear for them to be among the crowd that doesn't make it. We don't want that to be the case. This one simple fact stands out very clearly, that the gospel is for everybody. It's for whosoever will. But unless one repents, unless one comes to that place of surrender of their heart and life to Jesus Christ, it'll just go on as it has been. There's no assurance of heaven at the end of time when God separates the good and the bad. Now, there are many touchstones that suggest to us just where we are on the journey. Ways for us to evaluate our relationship with Jesus Christ. Just how good it is. How firm it is. How settled it is. Does the Holy Spirit bear witness with your spirit that the work is done? Is there that sense of the blessing and the smile and the approval and the leadership of the Holy Spirit in your life? If not, that's a strong indicator that you're not following Christ as you should. That should he draw the net and we come to that time of facing him where he separates the good from the bad, that you wouldn't make it. Is your life in harmony with the principles that are taught with Jesus? In harmony with him, in harmony with his word. No resistance to the truth of his word. No resistance to what thus saith the Lord. You embrace it, you love it, you appreciate it. You're grateful for God and his faithful way of speaking to your heart and showing you your weaknesses and showing you your need and maybe showing some sin in your life or something that needs to be dealt with strongly by the help of God. These are touchstones. These are some of the areas, some of the things that we need to be aware of, that we evaluate just where we are in our relationship with God. Is your relationship with Christ a meaningful one? Is it flourishing? Is it alive and well? Or do you only know him by name? Do you only know him by association? Or do you know him because he's real and he's living in your heart? There's a relationship with him. There's a connection with him. There's a bonding with him that's more satisfying than just coming together and worshiping him as we do on occasion here in the sanctuary. But it's a day by day, a moment by moment relationship. Do we keep ourselves pure from the polluting influence of sin? That's a massive touchstone for us to dwell on in our life. Lord, if it's something that is polluting me, if it's sinful, if it's wrong, deliver me from it. I don't want its influence. I don't want in any way to have it keep me from making it through to the city, There's coming a day when you're going to separate the righteous from the unrighteous, the good from the bad. And I want to be sure to be among that number who are welcomed into the glories of heaven. Are we genuinely concerned about those who need Jesus? Is there a burden? Is there a sense of concern that, oh, I want it not just for myself, but for others? You know, in a sense, every day is judgment day. It really is. In a sense, every day is judgment day. As we live, our works are tested. The swiftly passing moments reveal our character to those with whom we associate and in our day-to-day relationships. But the full story will not be told until the king separates the sheep from the goats. It's not going to be something I do or anybody else does. It's going to be something that only God does, only the Lord of glory, and he will not get it wrong. So don't miss out on the greatest privilege in the world, that of being a member of God's kingdom, a member of God's family. Respond to the gospel call and be sure that your response is a genuine surrender to Christ, accepting all of the implications of being a member of God's kingdom. No resistance, no rebellion, but surrendering all to him. This parable emphasizes the importance of us working together as a body of believers, as Christians laboring together in the kingdom to bring as many into the fold as we can, to see as many come to victory as we possibly can. I appreciated David Brainerd's dying words that I read in the course of my preparation for this message. David Brainerd's dying words were this: "My heaven is to please God and glorify him and give all to him and to be wholly devoted to his glory. That is the heaven I long for. This is my religion, and that is my happiness, and always was ever since I had true religion. And all those that are of that religion shall meet me in heaven." Hallelujah. What confidence we can have that victory is mine. This relationship with Christ is real, it's living, it's active today, and by the grace of God shall be active until he calls me home. I read of a machine in the Bank of England which receives sovereigns as a mill receives grain, for the purpose of determining the wholesale, determining on a wholesale scale whether all are of the full weight, whether they're proper and ready. As they pass through the machinery by unerring laws, as it passes through, it throws all that are light to one side and all that are the proper weight to the other side. The great separation happens, the real from the counterfeit, the genuine from the false. Nothing escapes the scrutiny, the evaluation. It's a process that is silent, but it's solemn, and it really brings to bear this parable to us that there's coming a day that we all will pass through the all-seeing eye of God, and he will properly separate the sheep from the goats. My question to us is, where will you fall? Where will we fall in line when he separates the good from the bad, the sheep from the goats? None of us are going to miss that day. None of us are going to be mere onlookers that day. We're all going to be participants. All of us, everybody who's ever been born will be a participant on that day when God separates the good from the bad, and those of unrighteousness, it says, will go into everlasting punishment. No wonder we seek to make our calling and election sure. Get it settled. Get it settled to go with God. Where will we be placed when that time comes? Will we be numbered among the just? Are you numbered among the just now? That's the sure way of knowing when we come to that time that we'll be forever with the Lord and not cast into outer darkness. Does the all-seeing eye behold us this very day as God-fearing children of God, real believers, Christians in heart as well as in name? Does he see us that way today? If so, he'll see us that way then. But if not, this parable should be a quickening. It should be an awakening voice to all of us and each one under the sound of our voice today, a quickening voice from God himself. Let there be no deception. Let there be no stifling of the quickening and the speaking of the Holy Spirit, the faithfulness of God showing you your need this morning. Don't resist that, but respond to it and let God have his way in your heart today. We will all be there, and none of us can alter the word of God. None of us can change his mind, because it's not that his mind is made up. He's going by what he sees with his all-seeing eye. I'd like us to stand together, and I would like us to consider just where we are in our relationship with God. There's a great day coming when the separation will happen. It's song number 336 that I think we'll sing as a song of invitation here this morning. Number 336. Think about the words of this song and think about what we've tried to share with you today and what the Holy Spirit might be speaking to you about this morning. If there's any doubt, if there's any question, why don't you make it sure today by seeking God on an altar of prayer, surrendering your life to him, confessing your sins, seeking his power to enable you to live a life of victory, that your sins do not condemn you. Number 336, let's sing it together. This altar's open if you want to seek the Lord. There's a great day coming, a great day coming. There's a great day coming by and by, when the saints and the sinners shall be parted by him. A bright day coming, there's a bride. This is the day of grace, the day of mercy. Jim and Gloria are here praying this morning. Those who would, why don't you come and join in prayer with them, that God would give them the experience they're seeking and yearning for. Anybody else want to just come make your way to the altar as a seeker? We welcome you to do that. It's never too late. While there's breath, while there's life, this is the time to seek God. Amen. And get ready. Get ready for the judgment day. It'll either be a bright day or it'll be a sad day. I trust it's a bright day. A bright day for all of us. Praise His name.